Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news-making headlines for Filipinos in North America. We begin in Arizona, where a Filipina mother is facing up to 2 years in prison for trying to kill her husband. 40-year-old Melody Feliciana Johnson, in Superior Court on Monday in Tucson, admitted that she tried to poison her soldier husband, Robbie Johnson, on two separate occasions last year by putting bleach in the coffee maker. Local TV station KGUN was in court at the plea hearing.
That you intended to harm, is it Robbie Johnson, by adding or mingling poison or chemical compound to water to your drink. How do you plead, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
Melody, who initially faced charges of attempted first-degree murder and aggravated assault, accepted a plea agreement for the incidents, which were captured on home surveillance. Prosecutors say Melody's husband, who works for the U.S. Air Force, provided videos he secretly recorded inside their homes since May last year, after he started noticing that his coffee was tasting bad. The couple has one child and is going through a divorce. The Pinay sentencing hearing is scheduled for May 10th. Let's go to New York, where hundreds of people gathered at the iconic Corona Park in Queens for a glimpse of the much-awaited, stunning partial solar eclipse on Monday. The 2024 partial solar eclipse was seen in all five boroughs of New York City. Filipinos were among those who looked up with their solar eclipse glasses in the Big Apple.
Once in a lifetime nga lang pong experience, so it's a treasure and privilege.
When the moon blocks the sun, it casts a shadow. And my teacher said the whole New York City is not a full eclipse, it's a partial eclipse.
The line of totality, or where there was complete sun coverage, spanned 15 states. But a partial eclipse appeared in all continental United States, according to NASA. And finally, in entertainment news, 40 years of the best in original Filipino music will be celebrated in California a month from now. After a series of sold-out shows in Manila, legendary Filipina singer-songwriter Odette Quezada will bring her all-hits 40th anniversary celebration concert to San Francisco and Los Angeles.
It's just as much a surprise for me that I've lasted this long and that actually my songs have lasted this long. So it's a testament to everybody who loves to listen to OPM.
Yeah. The friend of mine songwriter will also bring some friends to the stage, her longtime collaborator Raymond Lochenko, the Philippines' queen of soul, Jaya, and crooner Felson Palad. Quezada's two-stop show is a joint effort from the Filipino Channel, AIP Media, and Crossroads Events, and will take place on May 11th at the Alex Theater in Glendale and on May 12th at the Redwood City's Fox Theater. Tickets to the show are available on mytfc.com/OdetteQuezada40. And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
Donald Trump loses his second bid in as many days to stall his hush money trial, which is set to begin on April 15. The former U.S. president's lawyer argued at a hearing in a mid-level state appeals court that trial should be delayed to give Trump a chance to challenge a gag order in the case. The judge, however, swiftly denied the motion. A separate judge on Monday struck down Trump's request to delay the trial while he tries to move the case out of heavily Democratic Manhattan. Trump is accused of covering up his former lawyer's $130,000 payment to adult film star Stormy Daniels in exchange for her silence before the 2016 presidential election about a sexual encounter she had with Trump a decade earlier. The parents of a Michigan teen who shot and killed four classmates in November 2021, each sentenced to between 10 to 15 years in prison. A jury convicted Jennifer and James Crumley in a rare case of parents being held responsible in a school shooting. Prosecutors say the Crumbleys were criminally negligent for giving their then 15-year-old child Ethan a semi-automatic pistol as a Christmas present and for ignoring signs of his deteriorating mental health. The defense meanwhile argued it was impossible for the mother and father to imagine their son carrying out a mass shooting. The sentencing came after several parents of the victims gave emotional statements in court.
You show no remorse, no respect or compassion for our family. The same traits that you've bestowed upon your son. The traits that you have torn my family into pieces. The lack of compassion that you have shown is outright disgusting.
The ripple effects of both James and Jennifer's failures to act have devastated us all. This tragedy was completely preventable. If only they had done something.
U.S. and Israeli officials holding an in-person meeting in the coming weeks on the planned operation in Rafah. The city in southern Gaza is the last refuge for over 1 million displaced Palestinians. Israel also believes it is the last holdout for Hamas. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who earlier said a date has been set for the invasion of Rafah, says Israel will complete its mission of eliminating the militant group.
There's constant communications happening every day, but as it relates to this particular conversation, when they're going to be here in person, members of the Israeli government, that's going to happen in a couple of weeks.
We will complete the elimination of Hamas brigades, including in Rafah. There is no force in the world that will stop us. There are many forces that are trying to do so, but it will not help, since this enemy, after what it did, will never do it again.
The European Union and foreign governments have urged Netanyahu not to storm Rafah for fear of a bloodbath. And U.S. President Joe Biden has urged restraint, asking Israel not to conduct a large-scale offensive. While relatives of Hamas hostages met with U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris in Washington to demand the release of their loved ones, Hamas said on Tuesday that an Israeli proposal on a Gaza ceasefire did not meet the demands of Palestinian militant factions, but it would study the offer further and deliver its response to mediators. Around 130 hostages are still held in Gaza, 6 months into Israel's war against Hamas.
What we have heard is that there is a deal on the table right now that all of the parties agree to and are willing to work with. We are waiting now, and the world waits for Hamas to get to yes. It is in their court. There is no reason not to move forward on this deal.
A top U.S. military official raising grave concerns over China's dangerous actions at sea. Admiral John Aquilino of the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command says he's alarmed over the direction China is taking, especially when it comes to Beijing's maritime encounters with Manila. He warns China's actions show it wants to gain territorial space through force. The Philippines and China have had a series of maritime run-ins, including Beijing's use of water cannon, which caused injuries to Filipino troops and damage to resupply boats.
So, all of the nations in the region have the right to operate and gain the resources that are allowed to them inside of their exclusive economic zone. The Philippines are no different. And these actions are dangerous, illegal, and they are destabilizing the region. The illegal claim of everything inside of the self-proclaimed 9 or 10 dash line as Chinese sovereign territorial waters has no basis in international law, and it has been decreed by the 2016 tribunal that it, in fact, the Chinese have no legal claim.
Beijing continues to claim nearly the entire South China Sea, ignoring a 2016 arbitral ruling that invalidated its historic claims in the vital waterway. A Filipino woman killed while her husband is in critical condition after a fire hit a residential building in Sharjah, United Arab Emirates, last week. The Migrant Workers Department says 11 other Filipinos were evacuated from the same building. Aside from the Filipino casualty, four others were killed, while 44 more were injured in the fire. The DMW says it is working to address the needs of the affected Filipinos, as well as the repatriation of the victims' remains.
We're getting in touch with the family, and we, of course, express yung pakikisa at pakikiramay natin. And di magtatagal ay makauwi na siya. Pero yun nga, we will have to await the low signal of the UAE authorities. And of course, we're coordinating with our embassy and our consulate general's office, the DFA. In due time, of course, we will provide the necessary financial assistance to them. And kasabay nito, kung may legal implications yung pangyayari, we will also engage yung ating legal retainer, retained lawyer, para suriin ang sitwasyon. At kung meron mang legal liabilities, of course, we are also relying on the UAE authorities, no, yung mga investigative fire authorities.
Well, Manila's potential trade secrets are among sensitive information hackers may have accessed from the Philippine Customs Bureau. Andrea Taguines reports.
Contain the attack, limit the data breach. That's the goal of the Philippine Department of Information and Communications Technology as it works with the Bureau of Customs in investigating a hacking incident against the Bureau. DICT Undersecretary Jeffrey D says it was the BOC's help desk ticketing system and management information dashboard that were affected by the breach. A report by cyber advocacy group Deep Web Connect says these databases involve the personal information of over 2,000 employees and 80,000 BOC customers.
Information in the help desk ticketing system includes profiles of clients, and clients could either be importers, exporters, or brokers, no? Licensed customs brokers.
According to D, information on cargo movements and potentially even some trade secrets may have been compromised as well.
May mga nagpo-float na mga information about yung sinasabi mo nga about movement of cargos. Because if there are issues, you call help desk. It is possible that some of these information could be classified as trade secrets by the private sector, or by these businessmen and traders.
The DICT's National Computer Emergency Response Team has yet to determine for sure how long the hacking has been going on and who is behind it. But D assured the public the BOC's main system was not infiltrated.
The main system is called the E2M, or the Electronic to Mobile System. Well, hindi yun yung tinamaan. We will try our best to isolate the E2M. Kasi yung E2M, nandun lahat. May nakakonekin sa ASEAN single window, which connects all ASEAN countries. It's like an advanced information system.
Meanwhile, Customs spokesperson Jet Marunilla told ABS-CBN News there has been no disruption in the Bureau's operations. Moving forward, D again called on government agencies to heed the DICT's advice whenever the agency's experts detect vulnerabilities in their networks to prevent any more hacking incidents.
Yung mga issues na nakikita natin na tinamaan ang BOC, tinamaan ang DOST, tinamaan, you know, most of these naibigay namin sa kanila in advance. Masabi namin, may nakidetect kami vulnerability, baka tamaan kayo ng hacker. Pagtuunan naman po natin ng pansin para dumating po yung panahon na mas kakaunti na yung mga ganitong atake.
Just last week, the DICT also confirmed a cyber attack on the Department of Science and Technology, which resulted in a significant data loss. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine election officials assure greater transparency in the country's midterm polls after choosing the winning bidder for its electronic transmission contract. The Election Commission awarded the contract to a joint venture of iOne Resources Incorporated and Ardent Networks. The two Philippine firms clinched the bid amounting to 1.4 billion pesos. Poll Body Chief George Garcia says the new electronic transmission system will give more parties access to real-time precinct results in 2025. It will do away with the previous transparency server and will send precinct results to the telco exchange of telco firms before transmitting these to the data centers of the local board of canvassers and other stakeholders.
Bubulunan yung transparency server practically yung lahat na nakadepende doon na umaasa sa results ay mabubulunan din at hindi rin makakakuha ng kopya. And therefore, magkakaroon pa ng issue ng kredibilidad ng results. Sa kasalukuyan, yung ating transparency server ay wala na.
Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Good morning, Chanel.
Good morning, Bettina, and good morning to all. We're currently not monitoring any tropical cyclone or low pressure area within and outside our Philippine area of responsibility. However, a frontal system is affecting Batanes, so expect a cloudy sky with scattered rain showers and thunderstorm over Batanes. Here in Metro Manila and the rest of our country, easterlies continues to affect, so expect a generally fair weather with the chances of localized thunderstorm during the afternoon and the evening. The temperature here in Manila is to expect about 24 to 34 degrees Celsius and a heat index of 40 degrees Celsius. And that's the latest here in PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Chanel Dominguez, and good morning.
Thank you very much for that update, Chanel.